From BBC Radio Scotland, this is Sports Sound.
Don't be stupid, boys. Turn off Clyde, support your side.
I would like to leave this city. This old town don't smell too pretty. And I can feel the warning signs running around my mind. And when I leave this island, I book myself into a soul asylum. 'Cause I can feel the warning signs running around my mind. So here I go, still scratching around in the same old home. My body feels young, but my mind is very old. So what do you say? You can't give me the dreams that are mine anyway.
Should I go? If you say that you are mine, I'll be here till the end of time. So you got to let me know. Should I stay or should I go? It's always tease, tease, tease. You're happy when I'm on my knees. One day is fine, the next is black. So if you want me off your back, well, come on and let me know. Should I stay or should I go? Should I stay or should I go now? Should I stay or should I go now? If I go, there will be trouble. Decisions bugging me.
Indecision, they molest us.
If you don't want me, set me free.
Set me careless, you
me. Exactly whom I'm supposed to be.
Yeah.
Don't
step.
You know which clothes even fit me? Come on and let me know. Should I cool it or should I blow?
Good day, good evening, good afternoon, or good morning, wherever you are in the world. You're listening to the Half the World Away Celtic podcast from Hail Hail Media. My name's Kevin O'Neill, and I'm based in Mandra in Western Australia, originally from Coatbridge. And I was going to say, as always, but it's been a long time since we've been on, but still joined all the way over on the other side of the country in Melbourne, Victoria. He's my good friend, and he's still the housewife's favourite. It's Mr. Patrick Close from Airdrie. Good day, Pat.
From Melbourne, Kev.
From Melbourne.
From originally from Airdrie.
Originally from Airdrie, yes. Yeah.
It's quite scary, actually, because I've actually forgotten how to work all the controls. It's been that long. And then Happy New Year, Kev. That
happy
is how long
year,
it's been.
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas in heaven. Jesus.
And Happy
terrible.
New Year. All the best for 2016, and we're already a good part of the way through it. It's quite frightening.
Yeah, it is frightening. So I'm not sure if we should apologise or not, but it is kind of summertime over here, so it's kind of our close season, you could say.
Yeah.
So we're having a wee break, and there's just lots of stuff going on. And this, in fact, even tonight, we couldn't even get everyone together, which is quite sad. Poor Liam's off out and about tonight looking for, we always get an interview for a job, so.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
He might join us later. Depending when he gets home, but we'll see.
So we've been talking for the past, I think, 3 weeks. Let's do a podcast, and we've. I'm not saying we're finally here, but at least we're on air at this stage, so.
We are. But it's good to be back on, and we'll see how the chat goes. There's plenty to talk about tonight anyway, that's for sure. We are joined, although Liam can't make it this evening with us. We are joined again in Melbourne, Victoria, by our regular Mr. Martin Kelly. Good day, Martin.
Good day, Kev. How are you, mate?
Very good, Martin. Very good, and Happy New Year to you.
Happy New Year, mate. Happy Hanukkah, mate. Merry Christmas. You know, everything. Mate,
What have you been doing with yourself since we were last on here and back in late November?
Mate, I'll be honest, I've got three boys, and it's a constant run around in different sports with the kids. So Charlie had basketball tonight. Eddie's got basketball tomorrow morning. Harvey's about to start Auskick next week. They've had tennis during the week. They've had, more sports and more homework and everything. So that's really just been, you know, that's it, mate. I've been doing that. And, yeah, try to do a bit of bike riding. I'm trying to do a 60K ride in a few weeks' time. So I need to try and get some bike riding done. But that's about it now. So
Very good. It's the Aussie way, mate. Sport.
Exactly.
I've got to say, Matt, I do sympathise, because we've now got our youngest just reaching that age where he's getting into all these things as well. So we've got basketball Tuesday and Thursdays. We've got martial arts on a Sunday and on a Wednesday. We've got Auskicks and starts on a Saturday. What else have we got? Liam, so my oldest, he's joining the local sort of AFL footy team. So he's going to play on a Saturday afternoon. Owen's taking soccer. I've got to say soccer, it does my head in, but it's just easier. Mm. He's starting that on a Sunday, so it's bloody heck, man. It's never, you know, try to find time for you, but
mate, there is no time for us, mate.
No, there is time. I've actually changed gym. My gym I was going to it's pissing me off, so I've joined a new gym, and I'm sort of on a new sort of fitness regime, and I took up martial arts, but Martin was winding me up about the other day, so I've tried my hand at martial arts, which was bloody good fun. So I'd recommend it to anyone who hasn't tried it, just give it a crack. It's actually pretty good fun.
Which particular martial art was it? Mixed?
It was, now Martin will laugh at this, but it's not really a massively popular one, but it's called Krav Maga.
Is that a Taiwanese dish or something? A Thai dish or something?
No, is it any
relation to Paul McGrath?
Krav Maga, you cheeky bastard. This thing is like flipping street fighting. It's flipping brutal, I'll tell you.
So I can't see you being into that, mate. Street fighting.
I can always see you holding the coats at the back, Pat. Is that what you did? You hold, when a fight breaks out, you pick up the coats and hold them at the back or something?
I'll tell you one of the scary things. I do the beginners classes. I'm not any of the. There's some real hardcore guys. Actually, there's a guy from I met there from Lanark.
Lanark.
From Lanark, yeah. So he was I think he said he was actually a martial arts coach back in Denniston, I'm sure he said it was.
Mm-hmm.
So he I was getting chat to him. He's obviously not of our persuasion, you know, he's obviously not a Celtic fan, because he was he said a couple of things, you know, like that were put it this way, like it's pretty obvious. There's me, my two sons go there, as well. They go on a Sunday night. So, you know, Liam Owen and Pat.
Your names,
you know,
yeah, exactly. Yeah.
And he's never once said a
it's
thing.
It's like the roll call for the RA.
He's never said. But anyone who's, I don't actually know if you have in Scotland. Basically, it originates from the Israeli army. And it's apparently everyone who does, what do you call it, the national service stuff gets taught this. So it's more or less, it's all self-defense. It's not actually going out and street fighting and such, but just have a look at it on Google or on YouTube.
I would if I knew how to spell it. I'll need to just Google Paul McGrath, martial arts.
K-R-A-V-M-A-G-A, Krav Maga. It is flipping rude. So anyway, second class. This is the one that shocked me. Right? So basically second beginner's class. So I was like, oh, what are we doing tonight? Oh, we're going to teach you how to break someone's nose. Oof. I was like, yeah, what?
Charming.
Yeah, exactly. I was like, all right.
Fair enough. This is beginners, you say?
That's beginners. Right. Absolutely. It was flipping scary. And
getting right
in
there.
I'm not that good at it, but it's some of the guys that are flipping, you know, when they get all the pads and that on, they're flipping brutal. Not that happens very often. It's more all about, you know, it's sort of technique and all that sort of stuff, but it is absolutely... It's scary that this stuff even goes on, gets taught. But anyway, I was chatting to some of the guys there about who's actually used this in real life, and there's only a handful of them have, but it just teaches you how to deal with certain situations. You know, if somebody, you know, tries to hit you, you know, push you from behind, and if someone tries to grab you or pull your hair and all that sort of stuff. So it's pretty good.
You half them in two with a spatula or something. That's week three. Break their nose in week two. Cut them in half with a spatula week three.
If anyone in Scotland or anyone outside of Australia actually listening to this thing, in fact, if anybody's listening to this thing, let me know if it's popular or known elsewhere. But I'd never heard of it. It's just we were looking for martial arts for our kids, and we found this. It's local to us, so we thought, I'll give it a try. And the kids love it. They're because they actually get to, like, there's actually martial arts that other kids do, but you don't actually punch anything. You just do all the movements and stuff. This one, you actually
Tai Chi and all that.
This one you actually get to punch and kick and, you know, and wrestle and all that sort of stuff. It's good. Anyway, this is not a
Sounds a bit rough for me.
Boys, we're trying to keep this under an hour.
we're only up to 12 minutes so far. Right, so, clock's ticking.
Right, okay. So, right, we've got plenty to talk about. Well, we've only probably got one subject to talk about tonight, and that's what we'll do, but we'll get stuck into it shortly. But if you do want to interact with us tonight, you can do so on via Twitter. And the Twitter handle is @halftheworld88. So if you want to comment or disagree with anything that we are saying or put your own points on, you can do that. Alternatively, there's always the good old chat room. You can go in there if you're on Spreaker to listen in. You can leave your comments or questions in there. We'll try and keep an eye on that. And if you do want to Skype us, probably we're going to try and keep it short if we can, but famous last words as ever. But the Skype name as well, if you want to look us up for future references, HalfTheWorld88. Well, hopefully Liam will be joining us later on in that, but we'll see how we go. So that's, I guess, the intro, but we'll get straight into it by talking about, well, the title of the song, and you probably heard, listen to the intro, it was The Clash with Should I Stay or Should I Go, which is maybe something that Ronnie's asking himself or has been asking himself for a while. But after that performance, the other morning, lads, Wednesday night back home, but the very early hours of the morning our time, against the mighty Dundee. I'll be honest, guys, it's the worst. I've been disappointed with a number of performances this season, but I've tried my best to try and defend Ronnie. Try to defend what the strategy is of the boards to, you know, try and find this talent from all over Europe or wherever, develop them in the team, hopefully do well for us and then sell them on at a profit. I get that strategy. I understand it because of the climate we play in and things like that. So I've tried to defend it. Pretty much all season long, because there's been a lot of Ronnie haters that I think have been over the top with a criticism of him far too early, in my opinion. But there's a groundswell now, and I just found the performance the other night diabolical in terms of there was no spark anywhere on the park, and there was no spark coming off the park. And that was the first time, and I'm not ashamed to say it. I've been happy enough to defend the guy, and there's been reasons why we've had some poor results. I think explainable reasons why we've had some poor results over the course of the season. But that performance the other night for me has changed my mind drastically. And there's got to be something. It's not quite got there yet, Pat. And maybe we'll come on to this straight away now, because when we were thinking on how we could do this show tonight, Pat, you explain this, Pat, because you came up with this little idea. But it's something we'd like to do. We've got kind of 10 points. Do you want to run through the idea, Pat, and then we can go through these and how we are trying to give our view. Very subjective view, of course, on how we score Ronnie.
Well, I don't know if we're going to do the scoring. I'm happy to, but if we don't want to do it. But essentially, it was one of those things, like, we'll just try to come up with a theme for tonight. And rather than just jump the gun and say, you know, we hate Ronnie, he's this and he's that, we thought we'd just let a look at it a bit more and a little bit more detail. And I'm not going to go into massive amount of detail about each one of these kind of topics. But essentially, I started doing some checking, and it was just some basic googling about, you know, what characteristics do you need as a good football coach, and you get all the sort of the wanky stuff about Football Manager and all that sort of stuff, and apologies to anybody who does Football Manager, but it was all stuff like that. But then obviously it was google.com.au, and football over here is Aussie Rules, and there was a link on an AFL page, and I thought, oh well, it's still football, it's still coaching, I guess you can sort of look at it I guess outside the square a little bit. You know, you've got your football characteristics for a football coach, but so the AFL have this thing about it's kind of like this kind of article about what you look for if you're recruiting a senior coach for an AFL club, and it goes into things like different characteristics and criteria you look for, like leadership and management of players and technical skills and all that sort of stuff. And I just started reading through it, and I was like, do you know what? That could actually form something for what we did tonight. So I just jotted down, was it 10 different criteria, and said, like, yeah, well, let's have a look at them and individually, I guess, and just give our rating and whether we thought, you know, Ronnie has succeeded or has shown some sort of promise, or he's basically failed in those areas. And I'm not sure whether we do scoring. I guess the idea I had was there's 10 characteristics. There's, you know, mark it out of 10 for each one, and I'll keep tally of them if you want.
Yeah, it's a little exercise, and we'll see how we go. All right. And so, feel free to play at home.
Right, so, I mean, you've got... I didn't put them in any order, Kev. It was just things...
Right, well, no, I've got them in front of me here, right? So are you up for this, Martin?
I'm up for this.
And it's all right. Nobody shoot us here. It's just our bloody personal opinions, and we're trying to judge from... well, I guess we can all explain it as we go along when we come to each little point, and we'll see what it takes us, right? So, the first one is... it's all about the game plan and selling it to the players and fans, right? Now, maybe my first comment on that would be, do we actually know what the game plan is? But certainly when Ronnie arrived, he was very clear as to what he was going to try and do. And he was very early to say that he wanted to bring fast attacking football, you know, the Celtic way, as we all know and love it. Or knew and love it. So I guess that was maybe his game plan and selling it to the players and fans. So first of all, Martin, how do you think Ronnie has done with that from since he's come in to up until now?
I think it was sold at the start very well. I think it was exactly what you said. We're going to be playing, you know, not quite Barcelona-esque, but players will all be super fit. It'll be beautiful, attacking, great football. So in theory... I think it's been sold very well, because it was funny when you talked about it, I'm going, I don't know if it is, and then as you said when he came in, that's all we heard about, you know, super fitness, eating all the right things, good athletes, but good, beautiful football, not, you know, Wimbledon long ball type stuff. So I think he's sold it well. Mm-hmm. I just don't think he's delivered on it, you know? Mm-hmm. Now, I think there is, and maybe we'll talk about it later on, but I think we're all apathetic at the moment. I think it's, you can see the crowds are down at Celtic Park. I don't know about your supporters club over there in WA, but mm-hmm. you know, I can't remember the last time we all got together to do much. No wonder even go to, you know, go and watch games. Mm-hmm. I'm getting up in the morning, so I don't think that's helped. But I think it was sold in theory.
Yeah.
I just don't think it's been delivered at all.
That's where we have to look at it. This is about selling it to the players and fans. This isn't actually where they actually carried out, because that comes next. So there's lots of overlap in terms of all these the points I had. You know, like some of that could come down to the promotion and the marketing of it and stuff like that as well. But we'll come on to stuff like that a bit later. So in terms of
if we're talking about right from the outset when he was introduced to everybody and he had these media conferences and all the rest of it in the prep. So in terms of selling it to the players and fans, well, how would you score that then? If we're talking about the early days, how would you score that out of 10, Martin?
I would have to get a 7 or 8. I think he came in, no one at all, I think, knew who he was. Like, in the run-up for a day or two, suddenly you start hearing about him. We all saw him stripping down and throwing the stuff. I think stripping down to his undies and throwing the stuff into the fans. Suddenly, you know, we're all like, who is this guy? And it, you know... So we didn't know anything about him. I think it was sold to as well. So you'd have to say a 7 or 8 in theory for that.
Yeah. So what is it, Mark? I'm the same as you. I've put down a 7. So is it a 7 or 8? What are you going to give?
8.
So you... Go, Kev.
I would agree. If we're talking about selling it and it was the initial stages, I think everybody liked what they heard initially. He is a very clever man. You can't deny that. He's an intelligent guy and he's quite an articulate guy. And given that he's speaking in a foreign language when he's over here as well, I still think he articulates himself well. So I think he sold it well to the fans. So I'll give him a 7. I'll give him a 7 for that.
So that's selling it, Kev. That's selling it, but how did they actually...
Well, then we go on to the next point, I suppose. So if we're scoring now in terms of on-field performance, so this is obviously right throughout his term there. I guess we've got to judge him. So has his time been successful to this point on the park? So, Pat, I'll ask you that one first.
Well, it's a kind of mixed bag, because if you look at the actual, I guess the Celtic managers, I was trying to check, I might try and find it again just now, but I think it was on Wikipedia and it was all about Celtic managers, and his actual, I guess, win ratio wasn't that much different from many of the other successful Celtic managers. I mean, you take out, I think, probably Jock Stein and Martin O'Neill, and that was, they were on sort of the high, sort of the 70% sort of mark, but you take them out the way, and you've, he was kind of there much for much. I think he was along the lines of what Neil Lennon had done as well. So I'm just going to try and find it.
Pat, I'm looking at it now. He's on, here you go, win percentage. He's on 64.15.
Yep.
Strachan was 65. John Barnes was 65.
Yep.
Dr. Joe was 58. Wim Jansen, 64. Tommy Burns, 55. Lou McCarry, 35. But do you know, like, there's not even...
What was Lenny?
Lenny, 70.
Mm.
And Martin O'Neill, 75. Mm. So I suppose there's a... And I remember watching it in a baseball movie, and they're saying to get you from good to great is a 1%er. You know, it's you know, 50 quick balls or something a season. You know, you look at this, and for him, he, you know, jump a couple of percent. Like, there's a lot of the names I was reading out there where, you know, you're going, shit, I didn't think he was that good or whatever. Actually, even Billy McNeill in his second stage from 87 to 91, 55%.
Yep.
That's a very interesting start, because anybody like of our era that was around at that time, the centenary season, when you only think back in that era with fond memories, and I would if you asked me about that season, I would say we could be unbeatable from anybody. Do you know what I mean? We could have whipped anybody that particular season, and we were fantastic. But when you then say that over this period of time when he was back, it was a 55%. It'd be interesting to see what it's like. Obviously, that season we did win the league and we did very well. But that whole period when Big Billy was back as well, I don't think anybody would have thought he did so poorly over the piece.
Now, keep in mind, though, Kev, that we are taking this from Wikipedia, which, from what I remember, actually takes it from a website called Soccer Base or something like that.
Yeah, okay.
So it's not, I mean, we're just going by what, you know, these articles say. So we didn't come up with the figures, but it did. Yeah. It made interesting reading. That was one of the ones I think I messaged you guys on Facebook. That was one of the ones I had a quick look at, and it was just, you know, you just think of what he's doing. I mean, that's it also depends how up to date that is as well, because obviously he's had a bit of a bad run in recent times. He's 100, according to this, 106 games, but it might be more like 120 games by now. So it's just it's obviously hard to know how up to date it is. But again, looking at the other figures for other coaches, he's not really that far off, you know, and it's, but, I mean, we're getting down to the actual, you know, that sort of on-field performance. I mean, maybe we're looking at it in recent times.
Pat, you're talking about on-field performance, and that is part of it, that our friends across the water aren't there, so we're judging them by a higher standard. So we're saying, you know, if you look at, actually even just Martin O'Neill against, was it Advocate that he was against Martin O'Neill? You know, they were there, they were spending big money. So realistically, if you could beat them twice and draw once, you know, over the four games, that was probably a successful season, where they're not there. So we're expecting to hump just about everybody, don't you think?
I think there is a mentality like that, Martin. Unfortunately, too, there's a lot of our fans think that way, and it annoys me a bit, because you're kind of damned if you do, you're damned if you don't. See if we were sitting 20 points clear right now in the league and we were unbeaten, we'd won every single game we'd played, you'd still get people whinging, because there's no challenge, right? Now, I think in a way, I'm not enjoying it, but in a way, it's certainly good for the league, and I don't think... Yes, we probably have regressed a bit in our performance, but I think it would be unfair on the likes of Aberdeen to say that it's just because we are shit. You know, it belittles what they've done. They were very good last season, and they tailed away towards the end. They're clinging on to our coattails just now. You could say that's, again, because we've had a couple of poor results, but... They've had a couple of poor results themselves, and they could easily be ahead of us just now. So it annoys me a wee bit, because you're damned if you do, damned if you don't.
Well, I was going to say, I totally agree with you there. Like, one of the things that really annoys me is that the Scottish press, like, there was a thing when, Barry Hearn came up and said, how come we've not got a sponsor? Right, and he said, if I worked here, the guys in the sponsorship division would be sacked if you could not get a decent sponsor. Mm-hmm. But part of it is, all Scottish media do, in my opinion, is talk the game down, right? And it's not, and I've said this in previous podcasts, it's not that Aberdeen are doing well and that the rest of the league has raised itself up. It's that Celtic are shite. Now, we can't even win, because if we're winning by 20 points, what did we win the league by last year? Was it 15 points or something?
It was pretty comfortable.
Right,
in the
it was comfortable,
end.
Right? So it was comfortable in the end, but it wasn't. It was still, well, the league shite. So of course they won by that far. We're still doing all right. Like, there was certainly some stats probably about a month or two ago that we were either on par or above the games we'd won last season, and that we'd scored more goals or something. You know, it was very much on a par with last season. But it was being judged that, oh no, you should be 20 points ahead at this point. But I think there's a lot of things at play. I think financially we've had to tighten our belts, because we don't have those four big games every season. We don't have as much money coming in. That's just a fact, basically. But then on top of it, we are playing less. You don't have those big games, so you don't have probably as many people buying season tickets, because there's no need to buy season tickets. So, yeah, I totally agree with you. It's dead easy to talk down the game, when actually, I think Aberdeen are doing well for themselves, and they should be getting talked up.
I mean, Pat, if we go back to the on-field performance, we'll try and summarise this part then, the on-field performance. So I think it is quite a tricky one, because there have been there have been a few reasonable performances in his time there. The one that always sticks in my mind, and I was just checking there to see when it was. I knew it was early on last season after we'd get the bloody Champions League debacle had kind of, we thought we were done with that anyway, but it was quite early in the season, and it was against Dundee United at home, and we scalped them 6-1. And that was the first time I thought, all that stuff that this guy's been talking about closing down early, about fast passing, and I think we saw it in that game. We saw everything that they talked about in that game, but I honestly struggle to recall another game since then. Now, that was August 2014. I struggle to think on another game where we've hit the kind of heights in terms of the actual performance. I know we humped Hamilton 8-0 or something like that as well fairly recently and things like that, but I cannot remember another on-field performance that ticked the boxes of what he tried to sell to us originally. So I'm going to see if it wasn't for the result against Dundee the other night, I would have probably scored him a 5 out of 10 for his on-field performances to date, because there has been ups and downs. But I'm now going to score him a 4 because, again, as I said right at the start, that's the worst performance. I know people will disagree and they could pick hairs in it and all the rest of it. But for me, overall, as I said, there's been reasons in my mind why we've had poor results earlier in the season. You know, the Ross County game, a lot of people were up in arms about that. But, you know, if we hadn't had bloody Effie sent off, we could have been 3-0 up in the first few minutes in that game, and then we have Effie sent off and we're playing the majority of the game again with 10 men. It was always going to be difficult. So you can point to things like that, and I can look back in it probably a little bit more, I don't get as het up over here because I can try and forget about it quickly the next day. I'm not going into work and there's a few huns waiting at your desk to rub your nose in it or something like that if you have a bad result. So when it's for games like that, I've been able to say, no, in the cool light of day, you know, we played not brilliantly, but the opposition actually were well organised, whatever. But the other night, diabolical. We were the poorer team and there was absolutely no clues to what was happening. So for that reason, I'm going to give him a 4 out of 10 for the on-field performances. That was a very long explanation. But Pat, what about on-field performance? Has his time been successful to this point?
A bit of a mixed bag, I think, mm-hmm. same as you. In terms of mm-hmm. the actual end result, we're probably, you know, again, just looking at the stats of, you know, win-loss ratio and stuff like that. But let's face it, watching it, like, I've been having to get up at flipping, I don't have to get up. I've been choosing to get up at flipping 2 and 3 in the morning and stuff like that to watch these games, and it is mm-hmm. fucking tough watching mm-hmm. it because it is fairly dire. It's yeah. not in any way exciting. I'd say the reason, well, it is exciting in a way because you actually don't know what to expect. It's actually, you know, you're kind of on the edge of your seat a little bit, or more mm-hmm. the edge of the bed, because I'm lying in my bed watching it the most of the time. Yeah. You know what I mean? That's the sort of level you're getting to where you're actually nervous because you just don't know what team's going to turn up. Is it going yeah. to be a team that's going to start these games and, you know, sweep teams away right at the start, you know, but everything just seems to fizzle out. We're predictable, you know, there's no sort of excitement in the team. So I'm kind of with you, like, in terms of, we're still top of the league, but we're still in the Scottish Cup, you know, we haven't qualified for Europe, you know, it's all these sort of things mixed in. So I'm going to say it's an average. I'm going to give it a 5, I reckon, but
yeah,
it's lucky even to get that at this stage. But I would, and in truth, I probably would have even said, probably if even the end of last season, maybe a 6 mm-hmm. as well, you know, because, okay, we win the league and all that sort of stuff, but let's face it, the writing was kind of on the wall last season, I reckon. Mm-hmm. I don't think it was anything really that exciting to get, you know, get people to actually go to games, and I think you know, obviously attendances are dwindling, so I'm sure it will again next year if they don't, you know, if he's still there, more or less.
Mm.
Anyway, that's my, I know it's not much a summary, but anyway, Martin,
did you get a score for that one, Martin? What was your score going to be for that on-field performance?
Oh, sorry, I've got another couple of small comments to make about it, though I know we are trying to move through them quickly. Big games, I'm always wary of
That's the next point, actually. That's the next point. So give us your score. Give us your score for that. On-field performance.
Four or five. Do you know what?
Don't give me a 4-5. It's 4 or 5. I'm not going to 45.
I feel I've been conned. I feel I was sold a fast, attacking, beautiful playing team. And that's not what I've got.
And it's the amount, it's the length of time further down the track. We'll say, you know, managers need time to bed in, but we're not just talking for 2 or 3 months in it here. He's had quite a lot of time to do something. But anyway, right, so we will move on to the next point three, or the next criteria, which is the big match success that you hinted at there, Martin. So
yep.
has Ronnie won the bigger critical matches? This is a fairly easy one for us, I think. So your thoughts on that, Martin?
Well, I'll just put a wee caveat here. Mm. I always felt under Strachan and Lennon that they would always be, they couldn't win the big matches, but they would win them, and then I go, that wasn't a big match. And you go, hold on a minute, you know, we've beaten this team. I mean, should have beaten them. So I think at times it's dead easy to look over them. I think there's some stuff that, you know, we lost, you know, semi-finals or finals with absolute dodgy penalties, but realistically, we've not really done anything in Europe, and they are the big matches for us, realistically, you know. The whole line, we should have won a treble. Trebles are extremely hard. I listened to a podcast the other night when... and God rest their soul, Rangers were doing their 9 in a row. They only won one treble. Trebles are actually, and that's what I heard. I actually thought it was more than that, but that's what they said in the podcast the other night. To me, big match success are crucial matches. I'd give them a 3, if that. Mm-hmm. You know? But I'm always wary, just slightly wary, because it's dead easy to go, he doesn't win the big matches. Well, tell me, you know, line them up, because too often we win them and it's not, that wasn't a big match. But he won the league for us last year by a canter, but we didn't do much in Europe. We didn't do much in Europe. We didn't do much in the cups, you know?
Yeah. No, I think it is a fairly easy one to score this. I think we would all agree, and it's easy to agree that it is a subjective thing, what's a big match, but I guess we look to Europe as being the biggest matches in our season, the biggest, and unfortunately they all come very early on because we've got qualifiers. But then we looked at our domestic cups as well, and we were very unlucky last season with the decision that went against us in the Cali Thistle game. But again, he was kind of judged for that, which I think was a little bit unfair. But I would have to agree. You can't really say has he won the big critical matches. Well, he's not, unfortunately. So I'd have to give him a 0 for that one, Pat. Oh. What about yourself?
The only big game I can really think of that, well, maybe two, the comeback game against Aberdeen, that was late last year.
Yes.
At Pittodrie.
Virgil equaliser.
Yep, and yep. The Sevco game, that's about the only two I can think of that he's actually pulled some out of the bag.
Mm.
The Sevco game, that... we were expected to win, but to be fair, there'd been a lot of pressure on him and on the club because we were in a no-win situation. You know, right. If we smack them, they're, you know, a second-rate sort of Scottish team. If they beat us, we've just lost, you know, the first Glasgow, the first sort of Glasgow Celtic Rangers derby, with, you know, all that sort of pressure was on it. So to be fair, that was it. So I wouldn't score 0, but it wouldn't be very high up, maybe, I don't know, a 3.
Yeah, same as
Martin. He's probably lucky with that.
It's funny, because see how you talked about that, the game up in Aberdeen when Big Virgil scored the last minute. Was that an equaliser or a winner?
I thought it was an equaliser. I thought, was it 3 each? No?
Was it a winner? Was it a winner? Was it a winner?
I'll check.
It was a last-minute winner. Wait a minute, I think I've got it here. Was this it here? Saturday, 12th of September, would that have been it?
No, was it not late in the season, though? Was it not late in the season?
I don't know.
Must have been. Anyway, yeah, it was quite... It was a, when you said it was a big game, now before that match kicked off, it was an important game probably, but see if we were 2 or 3 nil up in that game, you would never have looked back at it as a big game. But what made it a big game is because Virgil did get that last minute goal, and it was just the whole passion and excitement that came out after that, and that was the whole Ronnie Roar, the start of the Ronnie Roar stuff, wasn't it?
Right.
At that time, so it's games like that turn themselves into big games, and you could say. And remember when Lenny was under a lot of pressure, and we were at Rugby Park, and we were bloody 3-0 down in a game at Rugby Park, and we came back and we drew it 3-3. But that was a huge turning point for him. And although, you know, on the face of it, you'd say, Christ, there's 2 points dropped. Just the manner of it, everybody came out of that game feeling pumped. And that was a strange turnaround for him. So it's funny when we talk about big games, because there can be really important games, but I guess we always think it's the European games that are the big ones in the cup competitions. So he's not scored too well for us there. I think he's only got 6 points out of possible 30 from the three of us there. So point number four is player development. So, Pat, are the players improving under Ronnie's guidance?
Again, a bit of a mixed bag, because some have and some have pretty much went backwards. Mm. You think of, you know, Johansson, one of his old boys.
Yes.
Brilliant last year, this year just shocking.
Yeah.
Well, there's been a few of them. Against the central defence is kind of new. We can't really blame that.
Yeah.
Gordon's maybe going back this year. I don't know. Then you look at guys like, you know, Kieran Tierney's obviously come on. Roderick's done well. Lee Griffiths has done well. Mm. So there's, I don't know.
It's a mixed bag.
It is a mixed bag. So, I mean, I'm not going to be too harsh, because he's done well with certain players. I mean, Van Dijk last year was unbeatable. And
yeah,
I guess some of that, I mean, he's obviously a very, an amazing talent, but some of that's got to come down to what Dyla was doing. So,
yeah.
In a way, I feel, because obviously the next one's going to be about player recruitment, and I feel a bit sorry, because there's all these kind of rumours and innuendo going on about, you know, he's not actually signing the players, and you kind of feel from that, in a way, that if that's really the case, that he's been given players that, you know, pretty much substandard, not to the quality that he'd expect or want, but he's still got to work with it, and he's got to improve it, and he's got to make, you know, and increase their value. But then there's other part of me that says, you know, like he's got Stuart Armstrong, he's got Mackay Stephen, who's good players. No idea why they signed Chifchi, but you know, there's guys like that who they've just gone backwards. They were amazing talents in Scottish football, and you know, you play Armstrong in the left wing and stuff. I just don't get it. So he's been successful in certain regards. James Forrest has gone backwards as well.
Yeah,
you know, but then you look at the other players. You know, he's given Tierney a chance. He's I mean, McGregor was looking good for a stage, but I don't kind of fancy him either. But you know, there's other players like Stokes has been, you know, he's been farmed out to Hibs. It's just,
yeah.
And he was, to be fair, he was still one of the better goal scorers we had, but he's obviously went backwards. So I'm sort of touching on a 4 or 5. I'll probably end up with a 5. Yeah, I'll stick with a 5.
Cause
been a mixed bag.
You've covered it very well. Pat, and before I come at you, Marty, I'm just going to read out Tom Doherty. Tom, thanks for sending a tweet there. But Tom's put on, it was something that MB Bodeep had tweeted yesterday, and it was the Scottish Premiership after 28 games. And last season, so we were sitting on 66 points. Aberdeen were 6 points behind on 60. This season we're on 63 points, so three points worse off at the same point we were last season. Aberdeen were on 59, so 1 point off where they were. So there's not much in it. We'd actually lost one more game at this stage last season than we had now. We've drawn a few more. We had 121 last season. We had 121, drawn 3, lost 4. This season we've won 19, drawn 6, lost 3. Our goals, goal difference is interesting, though. Last season we'd scored 56 goals after 28 games in the league. This season we've scored 70 goals. The goals against column, that's quite interesting as well. And as we all know, we all loved our Virgils and deniers on this show. goals against last season, only 14. Goals against this season, 22. So, I mean, still not ridiculous. Our actual goal difference this season, we're better off after 28 games. We're plus 48. We were plus 42 at the same stage last season. So it puts a bit of perspective on it. But again, it's all about the trend right now. And the trend from our last two games is that we haven't scored a single goal in open play. In the last two games, we scored a penalty against bloody Hamilton Accies, and unfortunately I didn't see that game because I was out and I'd set the alarm, but I was a little bit tipsy and I slept through the bloody thing. And then when I saw the scoreline, I didn't bother watching the game, so I can't comment too much on that. But it's worrying that we've struggled to create chances, goal scoring chances, and how, you know, how much do we rely on bloody Lee Griffiths if he was out injured, or he picks up an injury between now and the end of the season. It's worrying. So anyway, thanks again, Tom, for that tweet. It was quite interesting to look at that. But we'll get back to this player development idea. So Pat, you were going with about a 5, I reckon, there, because it was that the kind of mixed bag. Some have done well, some haven't. Have you got any different views, Martin?
Look, not really. The only thing I see, I'm taking player development compared different from, you know, Pat mentioned about buying players, so I see that as recruitment.
No, that's coming next. I'm talking about players at his disposal. So
yeah, no, but you okay? Look, to me, I'm agreeing with Pat. Look, I'm not seeing a lot of players set the header on fire. There's a few that you go, he's doing all right, but I'm not seeing leaps and bounds. So, about a 4, I think.
Yeah, and I've not got much more to add because I think you summed it up pretty well, Pat. There is some mixed bags. Kieran Tierney's the obvious one that, again, we'll never know. Would Tierney have been in this team? Would they have been put into the team under a different management? We know that Dial, a part of his thing was to give youth a chance, and Kieran Tierney's come into the team fully deservedly, and he's been given his chance and he's taken it, and he's been one of our more consistent and better performers recently, I think, as well. For somebody so young, I think he's done really well. So I'd like to be able to give Dial some credit for that, because he threw him in. He wasn't scared to throw him in at such a young age, over experience, whereas I think a lot of managers might have thrown him into the odd game, but I don't think we would have seen as much of Kieran Tierney under some other managers that we past or future, I suppose.
Sorry, I was going to say, Kev, one thing on player development. Mm. Now, I do feel sorry for Celtic managers, because there's always this, give the young boy a chance and you'll give him 2 or 3 runs in the league, and, you know, we'll put up with that. But then if we lose 2 games, then we're doing a podcast saying, will I stay or should he stay or should he go?
Good point.
But then the other side is, see, even if, right, we blooded the other night 4 or 5 guys and we did lose or we drew, and you went, but at least we're giving them, do you know, at least we're giving them a try, or, you know, and we said, right, see, in the League Cup, or under 23s or under 25s, or, do you know what I mean? Like, I think we're drawn anyway, and we don't seem to be given enough of them. And I do feel, as I said, they're in a no-win situation, but it's a sort of vicious circle. So
it's a very tricky one again, because the league's too important to. And again, if we were 20 odd points clear, then you could say fair enough. But at this stage, I don't think it's the answer. It's potential suicide by saying just throw the youth on, because again, you're damned if you do, you're damned if you don't. You could get a pat on the back when you see some youth players in the team, and then if they lose the plot or they just aren't up to the case and you drop points, then you're an idiot for playing the youngsters. You don't win anything with youngsters, as somebody famous once said. So it's that whole balancing act, but I think the pleasing thing for me is that Tierney's come in and he's stuck by him, and he's not, you know, the other thing as well, you know, you don't want to burn them out, you don't want to burn the youngsters out. Again, if you're good enough, you're old enough, And they've got to stop trying to treat these younger players like wrap them in cotton wool and that kind of stuff as well. If they are good enough and they deserve their place in the team, and they'll show a level of maturity that I think Tierney does, then you've got to stick by them. You have got to stick by them and do that. So, yeah, I think we're all in agreement that it's a bit of a mixed bag. Some players have not performed or actually regressed under them. Maybe some more of the senior players, if we call them that. But there's definitely the likes of Tierney who has matured. And you would like to think the likes of Van Dijk, the likes of Denier when he was there, they progressed under Dyla's management. You can't deny it. There's got to be something there. So it has been a bit of a mixed bag. Tommy Rogic, you mentioned him as well, Pat. He's definitely been given some chances. That he was the type of fringe player that I don't think previous managers fancied too much. But Tommy Rogic has done reasonably well for us. He's been out injured recently, and I think he was pretty poor the other night, I have to admit. But I would forgive him, given it's his first game back for a while. But so it's sounding as if we're all going for kind of fives again for that particular one on the development side of thing.
Well, it's all Martin very said four already. So I've given a five, Martin said four.
I'm going for a five. So very average again. So 0.5 then comes to... So that was player development. Now we're talking about, you hinted at this, Martin, player recruitment. So have Ronnie's signings been a success?
Right, I'm going to write some of them off here, right? I'm getting this from a couple of different sources. Michael Duffy from Derry City, Stefan Skipovic from Partizan Belgrade, was it? Yep.
Michael Duffy, is he actually still playing with us?
Yeah, well, he was loaned out to some mob in Spain, wasn't he? Let me just rhyme for him. So Gary Mackay-Steven, Stuart Armstrong, Dedrick Boyata. Let's go to the next page. Sadie Janko, Logan Bailey, but whatever how you pronounce his name, Logan Baye. Nadia Chifchaichichi, Scott Allen, Ryan Christie, Jozo Simonovic, Carlton Cole, Eric Sviachenko, and Colin Kazim Richards. So without going through every single player individually, because we'll be here all night, what do you reckon in terms of, you know, good, bad? There's actually probably, I reckon we've missed a couple there. But
it's the bloody mixed bag again, Pat, I would say. There's been a few shockers in there, but the thing that we don't know, and Martin, you made this point just before we came on air, is Ronnie the man that's actually saying, that's the player I want? We don't, none of us know this. None of us know this. And unless there's somebody out there that can tell us yes it is or no, but none of us actually know. Is it him that's doing the recruiting, that's got the final say in it? Is it the scouting team? Is it the board have the final say? None of us know. So it has been a bit of a mixed bag, but some of the really questionable signings, I think, again, have been Carlton Cole, which was a bit baffling, given it's a guy that's coming towards the end of his career, and you just don't even see him now. But also Colin Kazim Richards. I mean, this guy, we knew he came with baggage. We knew he had an attitude problem. We knew he wasn't a prolific goal scorer. And he's just shown all the signs of everything we knew in a Celtic shirt. He came on the other night and there was nothing to his game at all, other than a little bit of niggling and a bit of aggro and puts himself about. He's the type of player that just could get himself into trouble, get needless yellow cards and red cards. It's as if he tries to play to the fans, and that's how he could endear himself to the fans, by putting himself about, by sticking a boot in or something like that. But I think he's got the wrong idea if he thinks that's going to impress them, most of us.
Right, boys, again, without going through individual players, there's a couple that I have missed. I don't know if I mentioned Ryan Christie.
Yeah.
Tyler Blackett was another one, which I didn't put in there. What was the other one there I saw before? John Guidetti was one of his. Mubarak Wakaso. Jason Denier, I think, was one of his boys, wasn't he? Tonev, one of your favourites, Kev, Joe Ingebergit. So there's, and obviously the latest one as well is Patrick Roberts. So, so there's another, again, I don't know if it is a mixed bag there. I reckon there's more bad than good.
Oh, there's more bad than good without a shadow of a doubt.
Sorry, Pat, how many names have you just read out? So, like, ballpark?
Because 20-something, probably.
I'm sure it is about 20 signings. I'm sure I read that the other day, that he's signed 20 players in his time there.
Right, so that's been since 6th of June 2014. Jesus.
I found this is an article. This is a little bit out of date, because I think there's a couple of players in this article saying 21. Mm. I did see another article that said 23, so... I'll read out, and this is no order. This is from Talking Boz website, which if you ever go to, it's not a bad website. It's Carlton Cole, Simonovic, Ryan Christie, Tyler Blackett, Scott Allen, Chifche, Logan Bailly, Siri Janko, Dedrick Bayata, Stuart Armstrong, Gary Mackay-Steven, John Gaudetti, Stefan Skepovic, Ocasso, Jason Denier, Tonev, Berget, Craig Gordon, which it was one of his, I suppose, and Kazim Richards and Patrick Roberts. Mm. Mm. Michael Duffy is the last one, but he wasn't really seen in him, so we can't really talk about him. But
There's a few that have come in and they've been okay, and there's a few that have got potential, but there's a few real duffers in there, and you scratch your head and think, why the hell did we ever sign them? It was never going to work out. So I think, but again, this is where, as I said before, it's, if it was Dyla's choice, and we all knew it was Dyla that was bringing these players in and identifying these players and saying, no, that's my target, I want him, then you could say it's a score against Dyla, but we honestly don't know. I have my doubts it's Dyla that picks them. I think it's just there's a list of players they work down, and he's the manager or the head coach, he works with what he's given.
Yep.
So I would give it I'll go for a 3 out of 10 in terms of success rate out of those 20 odd players.
Martin,
which is probably about right. Six of those players are probably okay out of the 20 we've signed.
Yeah. I'd maybe think the same. Like, I suppose to me, it just seems as if we're wasting a lot of money on players. We're not doing the Chris Sutton, the John Hartson, 6 mil.
Those days are gone, man.
No, they are. Gone. But we've signed 20, and I don't know how much he spent. But if you go, I remember looking at figures a while away, and it was 2 million in this boy, 3 million, and there's guys that are going, I can't even remember we signed him, right? Mm-hmm. Or he, you know, I don't think you go and break the bank, but could we spend 5 million on a slightly better player? Now, the hope is we sign a guy for $1 million and sell him for 10 or whatever. Mm. But I think I'd be lucky to give him a 3. But again, on the caveat of, is he actually doing it now? I know it used to be under, or what I've heard, under Neil Lennon. It was Lennon, Parks and somebody else. And either all three agreed, or if it was two agreed, Lennon had to be one of the two that agreed. And then it would go, I think it would just, you know, the board would do the final sort of deal type thing. But there's some of those players now, again, like somebody like Carlton Cole, I slightly feel sorry because you don't know what the deal is. So the deal could simply be on, he's on $50 a week, but guess what? Every time he plays, he gets $10,000. So it's not actually cost as much, and it's worth a roll of the dice. Or he could be on $50,000 a week and we're getting totally ripped off. So I'm always slightly wary of somebody like Carlton Cole.
Mm.
We don't know the deal. So until the deal, you can go, actually, that's a great bit of business. Or, Jesus Christ, I can't even believe we're spending that sort of thing. Yeah. But in general, I'd be giving him a 3 because there was players you were naming there that I couldn't slightly remember a signing. It wasn't, you know, there's that one where, you know, going back to the centenary year, Lex Bailey played 17 games. I didn't even know that sort of thing. I suppose there. I tell you, if I met them on a plane, they were there's some of those names who go, I'm a sellout player, mate, I've never heard of you, piss off, seriously, right? And so, I'd give him 3 if he was lucky.
What about yourself, Pat, then?
I'm giving him slight benefit of the doubt that I'm not totally convinced he's making all the signings, so I'm going to give him a 5. So, only because I've got those doubts about whether he has... not so much any say, but certainly the final say on who comes in. So,
mm-hmm.
So yeah, 5 for me.
Okay. So point 6 is leadership skills. Ronnie's leadership skills. So are the players playing for him, and how's the player discipline doing? So Pat, leadership skills from Ronnie.
Again, he talks a great game, but there's that old term of has he lost the dressing room? I think he has. You know, I think he has,
but only relatively recently. I think he's lost it with certain players very early on. So like him and Chris Commons have never got on right from the word go when Dyla came in the door. I think there's
a lot more of that though. I think certainly guys like even like Stokes as well.
He's
got his favourites, and that's, you know, probably most managers do. But I just think that I don't think you'd have seen the Chris Commons thing happen for many prior coaches. And I go back, I'm thinking even of guys like Mowbray. I just don't think they would have stood for it. And the fact that Commons played the match after that, you know, it spoke volumes for me.
Well, we are talking leadership as well, so it shows weak leadership, that kind of thing then, doesn't it?
Yeah, because you have to be, you know, you have to, I mean, you think of Lennon, the guy, I don't know what the guy's player, who the player was, but one of his sort of top goal scorers came to a crunch game a few weeks ago, and he basically left him out because of discipline, lack of discipline, I should say. So, again, I'm not saying Lennon's the answer and all that sort of stuff, but, you know, that's the sort of way that they have to play it, because these guys will, you know, they'll just, they'll essentially take the piss, because they are a big bunch of ego all rolled into one little character. So in terms of discipline, I mean, you don't know what's going on behind the scenes. I know there's been sort of so-called sort of battles between certain players, and other players don't like other ones, and I'm no doubt they've got their own little cliques of, you know, Scots versus, you know, non-Scots or whoever, or Scandinavians and all that sort of stuff. But again, that was the same. You hear interviews with Larson and Tom Boyd and stuff like that. They used to talk about the smorgasbord, or whatever the hell this sort of funny term they used to use. But
yeah,
you know, and it was okay back then, you know. But that's, you know, so I guess it's kind of okay now. But player discipline, I'm not totally sold. He's done a good job on. Other players, are they playing for him? No, I don't think. I don't think they ever have. I really don't think they ever have. I'm just going to straight for the score.
Any of them?
I'm not saying all of them, but I would say the majority. I just, because how many times have you heard in recent games of, it's not what he's done, it's the player's fault. The players haven't done what he's asked of them. So if the players aren't doing it, then he's the leader. He's the one that's meant to be driving them. He's the manager of those players. So if the players aren't doing what he's asking of them, then maybe that's why he shuffles things around so often. I don't know. But I'm not seeing those leadership skills, and that's not just for him. That's across the whole playing squad. I know Bruni's meant to be the man, but I don't even.
Well,
see that
I was
much
just
of it from him.
I was just going to say that, Pat, because for me he was possibly the biggest disappointment on the park the other night. I don't know. As I said before, I didn't see the Hamilton Accies game, but I'd read some comments that basically what's happened to Scott Brown, he was anonymous, blah blah blah, but that game the other night as well, I felt the same. And I was speaking to one of the boys the other last night on the phone actually, and there were 50-50 challenges in the Dundee game the other night that Scott Brown didn't win, and that's unheard of. But there were 60-40 challenges in Brown's favour the other night that Scott Brown didn't win. And there were a couple of occasions where he was trotting back. Scott Brown's usually the type of guy that's running about 100 miles an hour for 90 minutes of the game. I thought he looked as if he's put on weight since he's been out. I just don't think he looked fit. I thought he looked a bit disinterested. And again, for me, that says a lot in terms of his motivation. And he's our captain, for crying out loud, on the park. He's the one that's... The players do see it, and we have seen it. Whether you're a Scott Brown fan or not, there's no denying that the guy has got something there. But we didn't see any of it at all. We saw no leadership from him on the park the other night. He wasn't taking anything by the scruff of the neck. He wasn't geeing them on. It was just for me, he was, because he's our captain. He was possibly one of the most disappointing players last night, and that's what's, again, a bit frightening, because that does suggest that Dyla has lost the players. If our captain's not worked up for a, let's face it, it was an important game.
If you call podcasts, quite a few this season, that I've said this, and I still stand by this. The good Celtic teams, since I've been going to watch the team, have had more than one, certainly more than one potential captains playing in a game, in the team.
Mm.
At the moment, you'd look at that team and you'd say Scott Brown is probably it. He's the standout.
Mm.
But there's nothing. I mean, it seems true.
Well, Wüstig's been another. He's been back once again.
He has. I'll tell you, see right now, see if you to say, right, Scott Brown's out injured. Do you know seriously who I would give it to? I'd give it to Tierney. He's the only one that inspires. And he's the only one actually. If I, there was some interview I heard, Dyla, and it was recently, maybe it was Radio Scotland, I can't remember. It was certainly in the past couple of days. And it was along the lines of, he loves watching KT, as he called him. He goes, and I think it's one of those ones where he could do with, you know, another four, five, six of the, you know, Kieran Tierneys on the park. Now, look at the age of the guy. He always a Celtic fan, all that sort of stuff, but Jesus, man, he shows more spirit than all them put together. And that's, I'm saying that in terms of leadership, there's different ways, the way I look at it, there's different ways of leading. There's that sort of the vocal side of it. And again, it's the same in AFL here. You think of players that are vocal and they're right on top of players and they're hassling and all that sort of stuff. And then there's other ones that just lead by example. They don't have to say much, but they just lead by example.
Mm-hmm.
That's kind of the way I look at sort of a captain. At the moment, we've got neither. We don't have Brown. Brown might be shouting and stuff like that, but they're obviously not listening to him, and he's not leading by example either. The only one I'd say, and I was watching Tierney the other night, and I saw him shouting at flipping senior players. Players are not senior, but certainly more senior to him.
Mm-hmm.
Having a real good old crack, so I don't know. It's I'm scoring pretty low in that one. I think he basically has
one.
Yeah, he's lost the players for me. I think that's well and truly. So I'll probably have a 4 for that one.
I'll go a 3 for that one, Martin.
I'd probably go a 3 or 4. One comment I would make about the Commons thing. I actually thought at least Commons showed some fight. Now, you don't know, and it was I would never have played him next week. I didn't think it was an automatic he doesn't play him, but there was just that point where I think he has. I don't know if he's actually lost the dressing room, but I think Pat's right. There's no leaders on the field, or very few of them. And I'd give him a 3.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so on to the next one. Point 7 is communication. Now, this is with players and fans. So do the players and the fans relate to Ronnie? So I guess I would say on this one, and it's kind of linked into the last one, there was a media conference that I saw, and I can't remember after which game it was, but he spoke with real, real passion, and he was having a pop at the media, and he went on for ages. They couldn't get a question in because he just went on and on for ages, but he really did speak very passionately, and he talked a lot of sense. I don't know if you remember the media conference I'm talking about, but in terms of that, his communication skills, and again, we've got to remember the guy's, he's a foreign manager. English isn't his first language. I think his communication skills, and as we all said right back at the start, he did sell to us his vision of what he wanted the football to be like at Celtic. So I still think his communication is quite good. I'll be honest, in the last little spell, I've tended not to listen or read too much about what his interviews have been after games, because I'm starting to just get a bit disillusioned myself now, but in terms of communication, I think he started off really well, but he started falling away, and we're starting to, there's just some stuff creeping in now that there's maybe excuses for certain things, and you're thinking, Ronnie, for Christ's sake, son, you need to do something and turn this around quickly.
Yep, I think the pressure's on Kevin. That's why he's reacting. I think the pressure is, I think he's realising it now, the fact that, you know, you've got, it's not even your biggest rivals of the moment, but it's not the other mob from south of the river that are pushing. And I think the pressure will be getting not only from the fans, but from the board and that as well. Inevitably, it's going to be there. It has to be there. And I'm sure questions are being asked of him behind closed doors and stuff. So I just reckon there's lots of signs of desperation. And that goes from what he's saying, you know, the whole thing about Boyata, you know, like, oh, he dived in and all that sort of stuff.
Mm.
That to me is just, it's panicking. It's you know, he's essentially blamed Boyata for the result, you know. And it's, I think there's little elements of that creeping in, but in terms of overall, I think he's certainly an honest man. So, I mean, some of the things he's come out and said. I mean, the communication for somebody as his second language, I reckon he's been pretty damn good with the players and with the supporters as well.
Yeah,
and no, I would agree with that. I think it's, you know, it's, I think in a way I kind of feel sorry for him that he's, you know, strange in a strange land kind of thing. But I don't necessarily think he's done a bad job in the way of communication. So I'd probably give a 6, maybe a 7, Oliver. We think
I'm going for another 5. Unfortunately, I'm going for another 5. His communication, just because I think, as it's that. Sometimes I've seen him and I've liked what he said, but there's other things I've just thought, he shouldn't have said that, Ronnie. He shouldn't have said that. But yeah, not all things into account. I'd go a 5. So you're going a 7?
I'll go a 6.
A 6. Martin, on his communication,
overall. I like the Ronnie Rohr thing. I think he's on a hiding to nothing with the Scottish media. Like, I was listening to a podcast this morning and he said the thing about the penalty the other night and then he retracted it and it was, no, he should back players, he shouldn't back players. Too often we hear, I'll be honest, bullshit answers for coaches, you know, I didn't see the incident really because it happened right
in front of and all that as well, yeah.
No, it happened right in front of the dugout and the guy punched him squarely in the face, no, I didn't see it. Come on, we want, I say, honesty. So, and look, there's even stuff where, you know, he's been out and about and he's been in Celtic pubs, you know, without being, you know, not invited just there for a drink. So I actually think his communication is good and I think the Ronnie Rohr is good. But
That's died a death, that now.
But no, but I think
haven't seen that for a long time.
But that was, you know.
At the time, it was good. But, yeah, absolutely.
But realistically, it goes back to the first thing. I think we all bought into it. And it's now no delivering. So I think his initial communication was good, but I'm probably going to give him a 5 just because he's no walk to walk. For the honesty stuff, I would give him top marks because I much prefer that. You much prefer, you know, tell us the truth. Don't, you know, as I said, the big one is I've not seen the footage yet. Behave yourself. Of course you have. Like, I would rather have him come out and go, you know what, see from my angle, it wasn't a penalty.
Mm.
Okay, well, that's what he thought. Or because then, see, when he comes out and actually says Stonewaller, well, you might actually go, well, mate, okay. That's rather than, well, every time he says it was a Stonewaller. So how am I going to believe him, you know? So, aye.
Yeah. Nah, fair point. So you're going a 5 again, was that, Martin?
Yes. Now, boys, I need to...
No problem, buddy. It's late over there, I know.
So I don't know if you want to fly through stuff quickly or...
You can't even stay and get through. There's only 3 bits left, Martin. Jesus Christ, you know.
It depends how long. If we've got literally 5 minutes...
You go whenever you need to, mate. But we'll plough on with this. But you just drop off whenever you fancy.
Do you have to go for a wee jobby or something, Martin? Because we can wait for you. You know, it's fine.
I just need to go. So, you know.
Au revoir, then. Au revoir. Do you want to get through this so that we get the final score, and then we'll let you go?
Yeah, let's get through this.
The last 3, right, no comment, just score, right? Now, this next one, point 8, marketing and promotion of the club. I think this is quite a tricky one, Henry, because I don't think that's really Ronnie's prime focus, but I'll go marketing and promotion of the club, I'll go a 4. Martin?
I think the club's on to hiding to nothing with the other team there. And I think they promised great football and it's not done it. So, and I think you've seen, I said at the start, I'm apathetic about the whole thing. I'm like, did I watch that game? Did I not? So I would give
it's apathetic, but when it comes to...
I'm extra apathetic now. So I'd give it a 2.
All right, okay. Pat?
Actually, sorry, because this could have been the time to go... We're blooding youth. We're doing this. We're doing that, and we've not done it.
Mm. No, fair enough. Have you got a different view on it, But
I have. I reckon you're looking at it the wrong way. I reckon he sells and upsells our club as much as any manager I've seen. I reckon if there's anything you're going to score him high on, yeah, I reckon he does.
Okay,
I reckon he talks up the Scottish game, and he talks up our club, and he talks about how big we are. So I reckon you've got the wrong end of the stick. I'm going to give him an 8 for that. I reckon he's really good at it.
I reckon you get the wrong end of the stick. Close.
Well, it's marketing and promotion of the club. I think he does a good job of it. And I think he does actually sell the club pretty well. And he's certainly trying to put the mainstream media in their place by making them realize how big the club are, and not to take the club for granted. And the whole thing about, we're bad because, we're shit because Rangers aren't there and all that sort of stuff. And he routinely has little digs at them, and he reminds them, he puts them in their place. So for that, I'm going to give him an 8.
You'll like that. Well, that probably then, right, no, fair enough. That probably links into number 9 as well, relationship with the fans. So we'll stay on you with this one, Pat, then. His relationship with the fans, out of 10.
As a whole, over the period he's been there, I'd say he's done pretty well. The whole Ronnie Roar thing, and the fact he's coming out and he spends time with the fans,
Go to the games, especially the away fans and things like that.
Yeah, I reckon he's done pretty well with that. I wouldn't say that's necessarily a bad thing. So I would rate him pretty highly. I'd maybe give him probably a 7. I mean, if he'd kept going the way he'd been going and things were going better for us, I probably would have scored a lot higher. But I would say he's probably a 7. Yeah.
Yeah, Martin.
I'm really torn on this one. I think he's got a good relationship with the fans. I just think some fans don't have a good relationship with Ronnie. I think, I think no matter who we sign now, if at the end of this we decide, right, Ronnie's going to go, who are we going to get? And the whole non-Celtic minded type thing really gives me shits, to be honest. So, I think he's got a good enough relationship with the fans. I'd give him maybe a 6,
I'd stick with that as well. I'd go for a 6. I think there's always the very vocal lot. I mean, I've been a supporter and defender of the guy for a huge part of his term at Celtic up until very recently. I always refer to him as the Ronnie haters, because I think there was a few that jumped in that bandwagon. It's too easy to jump in the bandwagon, and a lot jumped on it very, very early, which I think was a bit unjustified. And I did read a few things as well. There's quite a few people seem to be taking delight out of the fact, like, I told you so. And you think, are you getting some kind of enjoyment out of the fact we drew 0-0 with Dundee the other night because you can tell us so? I don't think that's the way to go about it. But anyway, there is his relationship with the fans. And you've got to say, in fact, on this is more the fans rather than Ronnie Dyla, but on that game the other night, when, as I said, it was absolute dross, the Green Brigade were absolutely outstanding again, singing non-stop for the entire match. You could hear it clearly over the coverage on Celtic TV that I was watching it on. And I know there was like booing of the team off the park and stuff later on, but during the course of the game, and I'm not saying that was coming from the Green Brigade, honestly, I haven't a clue if it was or not, but during the game, the Green Brigade were just singing their hearts out, as they always do. So, fair play to them for that. I would probably score a similar, round about the 6 out of 10 with the relationship with the fans. I think he still does relate to a huge proportion of the fans. I think the ones that have been backing Ronnie have been in the silent, I would like to think the silent majority. But there's certainly been a hell of a vocal minority that have been make their thoughts known in Ronnie. But I'd go a 6 out of 10 as well for that. So we're nearly there now, Martin. You can nearly it's nearly time to go to your beddy boys or have your poo poo or whatever it is you need to do. Number 10, his personal qualities, Ronnie Dyla's personal qualities. So in terms of his intelligence, his work ethic, and his honesty as a man. Patrick?
I'd rate him pretty highly with that. I've liked him in terms of a character, in terms of a person he is. So in a way, I feel sorry for him. I think either one or two things is either the job's just too big for him, or he doesn't have the overall control that he probably would have wanted. So, and for that, I do have sympathy for him. So I reckon I'd give him an 8 for that ranking. I've rated him. Whether he stays, whether he goes, I think he is a person. Actually, do you know what? I'm going to go 9 because I do genuinely, I do like the guy. And I there think it's,
Very good. Martin?
I'd agree with Pat on a 9. I like him. I think he does his best, as I said the other night. I'd much rather a manager come out with an honest answer than the standard rubbish. So I'd agree with Pat.
Nah, fair play, boys. The number I was thinking was 8. Because, again, in terms of he's an intelligent guy. He's very articulate. I love the way he deals with the Scottish media and those press conferences. His work ethic's definitely there, can't be questioned, and his honesty, as you've referred to there, Martin, is I think he's a very honest guy, maybe too honest sometimes as well with some of the things he'll say. So I totally agree. He's a likable guy, and again, that's maybe why I've defended him for so long, because I feel it's a bit. Some of the criticism of him and some of the personal stuff he's been getting and all this piss off back to Norway stuff, I don't think it's called for. I think it's a bit disrespectful to the guy himself. I don't think he's certainly not there to do a bad job. He's there to do the job to the best of his ability. And I think, you know, we need to give him support, but constructive criticism where required, and I think now is the time for some of that, and hopefully we can get some answers and see some positive reaction from it. But I wish the Ronnie haters would temper their hatred for the poor guy a bit much, so I'd go for an 8 for that. So have you totted them all up then, Pat?
I have,
took us a little while, right enough. So that was 10.
Yep, so I've got 10. So what I'm going to, I think what we said, and this was just a rough idea. I said, right, so if you score between 0 and 50, then you basically want him to go now.
Mm-hmm.
If you score between 50 and 75, then he goes at the end of the season. And then 75 and above, he basically gets signed in a long-term contract.
Mm-hmm.
So I'll start at the bottom then, I guess, shall I? Lowest marks were given by Kev, a whopping 46 out of 100.
Bloody hell, I'm the guy that's been saying I've been defending him all the time as well.
46 out of 100, so you want him to leave immediately.
Oh,
Martin,
that's not
you
true.
You had a 47.
Jesus.
He just pipped Kev at the end there. Okay. So you also want him sacked before right now, in fact. And next was me with a 59. I'll basically take Ronnie Dyler to the end of the season, an exact bastard.
See, that's actually, Pat, I think they were all good scores, but I want him at least, I think, to stay at the end of the season. Because one of my things are, if we do, get rid of him. Now, it's not why we should keep him, where, you know, this isn't a we should definitely keep him, but if we're going to get rid of him,
it's what is the answer, that's right, man.
Who's going to come in his place? Which good manager is going to come and go, the guy the last 2 years before me has won you the league, which is the main objective, and then you sack him? So I it's one of those where if it carries on the way it's going, then even if we win the league but we're just playing terribly, and you know, then I think he has to go. But we don't know who's in control. Maybe, you know, he's only getting given players and he's having to just do what he can with them. So I think we give him to the end of the season. If he starts playing well and we win it at a romp, would I give him another year? I'm not sure.
It's a tricky one, because as we all know, football, it's a funny old game, side.
Yeah.
And things can change so quickly. Again, it's incredible to think that this game against Morton on Sunday is turning into a. It could it's not going to make Dyler, that's for sure, but it could certainly break him. If we stumble in this game at all, I think that's it.
But sorry, Kev, can I ask this? If we go back in our time, maybe Martin O'Neill was the one that could have stood against us. Celtic manager's only three league games away from getting the sack. You know, three league games. Now, one stat that did get tweeted, and I'm deliberately saying it got tweeted, and I don't know if it's true, but it's the first time since McCarry that we've lost 3-0 draws. We've drawn 0-0 in a season, three games at Parkhead. So I do think that sort of, unfortunately, that sort of sums it up. I do think all Celtic fans, three games away from hysterical and burning the buildings down. So
I think the timing of this Morton game as well, it heightens the pressure on this particular game, because again, on paper, it's a game that we should go out and destroy them. But just because of the last, particularly the last two results and performances, it's really is heaping pressure on Dyla. And this could be the game. If we don't win this game, then I think that's going to be the end for Dyla. I don't think there can be any other real outcome.
First, let me just jump in. Martin Kelly, you've been in Australia for too long. 3-0 draws is what you said, Martin.
Aye.
That would be 0-0.
That's 9 each. 3-9 each games. 9 each, Martin. 0-0 draws. You honestly have been in Australia for much too long. That's the sort of shite you see in Australian TV.
Thank you.
0-0. Fuck, Jesus.
Right.
It's like hitting the upright. You didn't hit the upright, you hit the post. And it's not a throw-in, it's a shy, right? And it's a by kick.
It's a shy.
Who are these people? It's right. Outside left, inside. Anyway, let's go on.
Okay.
So, yeah, Morton, I think you're right, Kev. I think the pressure on, actually, probably the next two games, because they get Partick Thistle away, which is another sticky one, you know, Glasgow Derby and all that sort of stuff.
Incredible to think that we're looking at these games with trepidation.
But that's what it's come to.
It really is.
I mean, don't be wrong. I mean, Aberdeen, they've lost two of their best players. Their top goal scorer is out. So that's their Lee Griffiths is now injured for like what 6-8 weeks. I don't know, I heard or read it the other day, but Johnny Hayes is out injured as well. I don't know how long.
Interesting.
So he's out. So they're basically probably two of their four or five best players
are out
injured. So, but we also spoke earlier about, you know, basically Dyla winning the big matches.
Yeah.
When the split comes, we'll be playing them at home. And that could essentially be a league decider.
That could
come down, you know, because we've got, just looking at the fixtures out, in terms of the league, so we've got Morton on Saturday, Sunday. Then we've got Partick Thistle away, we've got Kilmarnock away. No, Kilmarnock are mince at the moment, so we should be spanking them. Shouldn't be any park issues because it's an AstroTurf park. Hearts at home and Motherwell away. So all winnable games. I mean, the Hearts one's a bit of a tricky one, and then we get the split. And that's middle of April. So it depends when that Aberdeen game comes. But we need to be... Look, bottom line is, if we're 4 or 5 points ahead, it's still at that point. And Aberdeen come to Celtic Park and we get a draw from it, we're probably done all right, as long as they're not gaining ground on us. But they will be coming... You think about it, if that's a league decider, they will be coming with absolutely nothing to lose. They'll probably bring about flipping 8,000 of a crowd down to the game. And it'll be a fucking top game. And the pressure will be really on. So that's, so we're talking big game stuff. That's the one that's we're kind of leading up to.
Yeah, you know? You could be right. You could be, but again, it depends on how. Because again, bearing in mind what we've said there about the last couple of games in particular, that we haven't scored a goal from open play in two games. Which is the worrying thing for me. We've not really created chances against well organised teams. Now, again, on paper. Partick Thistle in the league, yep, we should be beating them. Yes, we should be beating Kilmarnock. The thing that makes them difficult is their away games, and these guys will be known that we're going through a rough period. So what should be easy games are going to be difficult games for us. And again, so much hinges on this result and performance on Morton. Hopefully we blow them away and we beat them by several goals, and then that's the little bit of confidence the players need, or the spark or whatever, this clear the air talks that he's been going on about. I hope to God they work, because it's getting too close towards the end of the season now for us to be to be worrying about a crunch game against Aberdeen at Celtic Park for the title. So hopefully that's not going to be a crunch game. Hopefully it's just a matter of turning up and blowing them away.
Can I ask you this now? I do need to run, but I'll ask you, just this is a yes or no. Mm-hmm. If we get beat on Sunday, is he gone?
Oh, I couldn't see any way back for him. I'd be honest, I couldn't see any way back if we get beat. It'd be hard to justify him being able to stay on. Paul Watkins just tweeted in saying, "Can someone calm Pat down?"
Pat, I don't.
Thanks, Paul.
I'm off calm. I think it would be a massive, massive risk to sack a coach this late in the season, unless you've got somebody who's just going to waltz straight in there and instantly change it. Sam Allardyce, let's get Sam Allardyce in. He's the saviour of all these teams, isn't he? Let's get him in. Well, that's the sort of thing, you know what I mean? That's the sort of thing you're going to look at. Like, who's going to come in and save the day?
You're right, but again, it's how bad does it then get? Because, you know, it's yet another result that's a shocker, and you're thinking, how do you get out of the hole by just keeping the guy there? Because he's then the guy that's got us into the situation, and he's went three games then with really struggling to motivate and get them out. So we're effectively saying we could be then losing, the risk of losing the league becomes greater if we go out of this.
And that's the thing, is it depends who you're bringing in. If you're going to bring somebody in who you feel is going to make an instant impact, that's fine. But if you're not going to get any better than what
he's, of course,
But if you're going to have somebody that's probably maybe no better than what he is, you know, because you can't change your game style. I mean, maybe the personnel get a bit of a, you know, the actual players get a bit of a boost if some big name comes into the end of the season. You know, if you do get a Martin O'Neill, right, Martin O'Neill will take over to the end of the year. You know, I know it's not going to happen, but somebody like that coming in with that sort of, you know, profile. But, you know, you look at other names around and it's like, no disrespect to them, but there's none of them just going to instantly install sort of, you know, inspire a support in the playing team or the playing staff. Maybe they would. Yeah. Maybe there's somebody out there that I haven't heard of or I don't know of. But, you know, that if you know, talk of Michael O'Neill, who I kind of rate as a manager. I don't mind him as a manager. I would happily take Michael O'Neill, the Northern Ireland manager, but at the end of the season,
there's still no guarantees. That's, you're right with what you're saying. There is no guarantees if that was to happen. I mean, I think, don't get us wrong, I think we would all say we don't want him. Ideally, what we want to happen is we hammer Morton on Sunday and we win every single game between now and the end of the season. And then all of a sudden, things are slightly rosier in the garden again, and hopefully we can see the stuff that was sold to us right back when Ronnie came in. But I would love nothing more than that, and then I'll be happy to, you know, not keep him on. But because what's more difficult is if he was to be sacked, and as you say, getting the right person in, because there are no guarantees. And please, the people that say, well, let's get Henrik and Lubo in as a management team, or let's get in, I think, for fuck's sake, man, are you insane?
Can we get Barnes and Dalglish back? Boys, I'm out of here, so see you later.
Right, Marty, all the best, mate. We'll see you soon.
Take care. Thanks a lot, boys.
Cheers, buddy. But enjoy your poo-poo, Marty.
You didn't hear that one. Plop. Make sure you hang up, Martin. We don't want to hear it. But that's the thing. I mean, it's like I just can't think of anyone who's going to come in and instantly change the way the club are.
I would agree. There's no magic wand, mate.
But looking at it now, right? So all the performances, and we're looking probably in recent performances, and you know, probably since we get chucked out of Europe, it hasn't exactly inspired, right? Simple fact is, Ronnie Dyla could at the end of the year have a double. What happens then during the close season? Do you turn around and say, "Well, wait a minute, you've won the double, but that's still not good enough"? Do you still get rid of a manager who's won you a double? Not exactly in style. I guess, putting it another way, is there any way back for Dyla in Europe?
I think a lot will depend on what happens between now and the end of the season as well. But again, as I said, and it sounds, right now it sounds farcical to say it, but if we do win every game from now to the end of the season and we actually do start playing really well, and again, there's guys like some wee Patrick Roberts. I felt a bit sorry for him the other night as well, but he's a wee player that he looks as if he could spark something. I think he was just, it was a bit unfair on him with the way the game was going. But, I mean, we saw he had a great chance in the first couple of minutes. He's the type of guy that if he gets on the ball, he could take players on and get by them once he gets a couple of games under his belt. So yeah. There are signs there. There has been signs there. Again, it's just this last couple of game things I keep coming back to that's been the real pisser for me. And we need to get out of this rut.
Do you think Roberts is more of a bit of a luxury player, though? The sort of guy that's okay when you're winning 2-0. But you think if we're playing Partick Thistle, right? And what, next week on Saturday?
Saturday, yeah.
Right. Now, he plays and, you know, I don't know what the state of the park is. I mean, from the highlights I've seen, it's not exactly in great nick. But he's playing at Fair Hill. He's going to get lumps kicked out of him. Probably the same when he goes to Rugby Park as well. Is that the sort of guy that you want to be coming on and fighting for you to win you that league? Or is he the sort of guy that comes on when you're 2-0 up and actually, you know, puts on a performance and maybe next year another goal or sets up a goal? I'm sort of between the two at the moment. It's like, you know, do you want him playing every game because he's got that creative side of it? Or are we at the stage at the moment we just need to get people who dig in and fight for the cause?
Because we were saying earlier though as well, wasn't it? That we don't seem to have any of them right now. The ones that we would think that we have, likes of Scott Brown and stuff like that, he was sadly lacking in that department.
Yeah, but
the other
you think
night.
Of the Dundee game the other night, like, and again, sort of just watching what Roberts was doing, he was sort of pulling out of stuff as well. There was certainly things that, and it's not his game, it's not really having a go at him, but he was.
No.
But there were certain situations where he could easily have put a tackle in. Now, he's chased back in that a fair time, he basically put pressure on players, but there was a couple of times where he could have tried to nick the ball past the player, but you know the defender's coming in at, you know, 100 mile an hour. He's, you know, probably 20 kilos heavier than the guy.
Yeah,
you know, if he catches him right, he's going to hurt him. You know what I mean? But it's just one of those guys. Is he going to fight for the cause? I'm not totally convinced he is, but still an amazing talent and stuff. But you know, maybe he's sort of guy okay playing at home, but if you're playing, you know, a Sunday night or a Tuesday night or a Wednesday night, or flipping, you know, at Tynecastle. He's maybe not the sort of guy you want to be what we're playing, you know what I mean? So
Time will tell.
Yeah, I'm kind of with you. Like, I know a lot will depend on what happens between now and the end of the year, but I just think I can't really see any way back from even if he wins the double. I really can't. I just think it's not so much with Celtic fans these days. And what was the thing? I was listening to on a podcast or one of the radio shows. I can't quite remember now. And it was along the lines of, maybe it was Celtic Underground, I can't quite remember. It was a whole thing about when Jock Stein was telling players to go out, you know, the first priority is entertain. And I think that's what Celtic fans kind of, I guess they kind of dream of and hope and expect, but I don't really
that's
think
what we all want.
We haven't really got that for quite
we're
a few
million
years.
Miles away from it right now, but unfortunately, a million miles away from it.
Yeah, I mean, never really got it. I'm not sure we really got it with Lennon. We got the results, you know, we're winning games and stuff, but was it really that great? You know, and I think it went, you know, towards the end of Strachan's reign as well, and people are just going, this football's crap. And
yeah,
but again, same thing. He's winning games, so But you know,
it's the usual fickle Celtic fans that we are, though, isn't it? We want everything.
Yep.
And even then, it's not good enough. There's always something to whinge about.
Yeah,
unfortunately.
The Celtic way, isn't it? That's a whole.
That's the Celtic way, and that's why we love them dearly, mate. And we do things like this.
So, anyway. Yeah, I don't know where we take it from here, but yeah, I guess we'll have to try and wind up because we've lost our wee buddy. So.
We will, Pat, because I know it's cracking. It's nearly midnight over there for you anyway, as well, isn't it? So.
I'm a second wind now. I'm fired.
You're right.
Let's do
another. I've got my Heinekens as well for me, but I had a couple tonight, and they weren't going down well, mate. I wasn't enjoying them, so I parked them. But I think I'm going to have a wee glass of vino when we wrap this up. I think that's the strategy now.
Plan. I'll line up with tunes in for the end of it then, so may as well. Okay. Any shout-outs, not Kev? You normally do.
Oh, I should probably. I should probably say that the Huddle Down Under Perth 2016 is certainly getting a lot closer now. So this is the weekend of the 11th and 12th of, well, it's it actually starts on the Friday when people start arriving.
The best, so that's when I'm turning up.
It's the 10th, the 10th, 11th and 12th of June. So it is winter time over here, but it'll still be reasonable, I think, in Perth at that time. I just hope there's not going to be rain that weekend, but it should be fairly nice weather, hopefully, for the weekend. But it's similar to what happened in the Gold Coast a couple of years ago, and the boys in the Perth CSE have been kind enough to stick their hands up and organise it, this gathering for. It's for anybody who actually wants to come across. It's primarily for all the Celtic fans right across Australia and New Zealand to get across to Perth and have just a great weekend of entertainment, laughter, plenty of drinking will be happening. There is going to be we've got a committee meeting actually on Monday. On Monday, it's a public holiday over here in Western Australia on Monday, so we've got a bit of a committee meeting. And Charlie and the boys are going to be coming over for, not the committee meeting, but they'll be over for the event on the Saturday night, which should be outstanding. There are pre-sale tickets for all Celtic Supporters Club members in Australia right now. So Davey Barclay from Perth CSE is the guy that's taking names for anybody that wants to pre-order. So for the Charlie and the boys gig on the Saturday night in Rosie O'Grady's in Northbridge, the prices are $35 for your ticket. And then on the Sunday, there's going to be a nice boat cruise on the Swan River in Perth as well. A three-hour boat cruise, I think it's going to be, and there'll be plenty of beer on it and some tunes on it as well. And again, that's priced at $35 per ticket. So as I say, these tickets go on sale from Sunday, but it's only open to members of the supporters clubs initially before there's a bit, it's opened up wider to the general public. So I'll put it out there anyway. If you yourself or you know of anybody that's going to be in Australia or round about, certainly Perth and Western Australia in June this year, it's going to be it's hopefully, if it can match the weekend that we had on the Gold Coast a couple of years ago, it'll be fantastic. And knowing the Perth CSC guys like I do, and knowing the infrastructure they've got up in Perth at Rosie O'Grady's and the support that the Rosies give the club, anybody that knows that place, it's fantastic. And Perth CSC always put on a great show. Our little Mandra CSC are doing their best to support it in any way we can. The original plan was to try and have the Sunday boat cruise down in Mandra, because we've got nice kind of canals and stuff like that down here, and some nice water inlets from the ocean, the Indian Ocean. So it's really nice as well. But it was just proven it was going to be too costly for people, I think, to run a bus. Mandra's about an hour drive south of Perth. And it's just the idea of doing that on the Sunday. It was proven to work out quite expensive per head as well. And then it's the idea going back up to Perth, and it was going to be a bit too expensive. So we made the call that it'd be far more sensible, and it'll probably get a lot more support if we just run it from everything in Perth. So that's the way it's working out. So as I said, we in Mandra CSE, our little club, will do all we can to support the event. And play a part in it by attending, certainly, and it should be really good. So look out for more information about it. And as I said, if it comes anywhere near the weekend that was arranged on the Gold Coast a couple of years ago, it'll be a fantastic weekend. You're coming across to it, Patrick, aren't you?
My flights have been booked for about 6 months, Kev. Yes,
you're a good man. You're a good man.
Yeah. No, it's good. The Charlie and the boys thing's a bit of a coup as well, so that'll
I should say there will be an ex-Celtic player, but that's still to be finalised and confirmed. So I won't say anything else about that just now, but there will be an ex-Celtic player coming over for the whole weekend as well. So we'll let you know who that is nearer the time, through Twitter or Perth CSC and Facebook. Or I'll try and give updates here when we do our next podcast. That'll probably be after the event, right enough, the way we're going.
Well, actually, let's
see we're doing these now, but
I'm going to put it out there, Kev. Let's try and get Davey or somebody, say Davey Barclay or one of the guys from the Perth CSC on.
Absolutely. Well, as I said, I'm on the kind of committee for it as well. Anyway, so we're meeting on Monday, so I'll mention that and I'll say I hope they don't mind me doing this. I didn't seek permission. I'm sure they don't mind, but we'll put it out there and I'll speak to the guys and see if one of them wants to come on one night and give us a bit more of a rundown.
That's right. We can record that up front.
Yeah, we can do something like that, I'm sure. I'll run it by the guys on Monday and we'll take it from there. But yeah, that's it. We've got the game on. Mandra CSC, the massive game against Greenock Morton on Sunday. We'll be showing it in Murphy's in Mandra. So if you're in the Mandra region at all, or Mandra area at all, get yourselves along to Murphy's and come along to watch the hoops. It's a decent kick-off time, 8 o'clock on a Sunday evening, but as I said earlier on, it's a public holiday in WA on Monday, so it's not a bad little kick-off time at all to come down, have a few beers, enjoy the crack, and hopefully by the end of the match we can say, oh, Ronnie, he's some man. Sign him up.
Two-faced, unbelievable. Two-faced.
I'm not two-faced. I've told you I don't. I would rather he didn't go. But if it's, I want us to just win every game from now to the end of the season, and then I'll be happy, man.
Well, put this way, like a cup game against Greenock Morton late on a Sunday night. So that would be what, after 11? Is it midday? Half 12?
It's a midday kick-off.
So 11 o'clock on a Sunday night. In truth, I would even be questioning, do I stay up for it? Because I've got work early. I'm up at 6 in the morning for work. But such is the actual importance of the flipping Greenock Morton game.
Bizarre.
I know,
bizarre.
I'm going to be up for it. So, yes.
Oh, my God.
It's kind of scary. But, look, that's where we are at the moment. We just have to stick together and get ourselves through it. You know, we obviously support the team as best. I know it's hard for us, all the other side of the world, seeing it. But, you know, if you are listening to this, support the team, man. This is the time. I was actually, something I heard today. I listened to one of the Radio Scotland podcasts, downloaded that. Mm-hmm. And there was some comment. They obviously got tweets in from people, and some guy had tweeted Radio Scotland saying, I've been a Celtic supporter for how many years? If we don't win the league this year, that's it. I'm not going back.
Mm-hmm.
Do you know what? You can fuck off then. Seriously, that just does my head in. Honestly does my head in. I just don't get that.
I know what you mean, mate.
Different. I've been over here because, you know, when you're an AFL fan, your team goes through peaks and troughs. When you're near the top, everything's going fine, but things just go in cycles in the AFL. You kind of get used to being down the bottom a little bit, and maybe it's different.
You do as a St Kilda fan, Pat.
You do, yeah. That's, shut up. We're on the way up, all right. We've got some young guys. We'll be doing all right. But anyway, this is not an AFL podcast. But you know what I mean? No. That's what I'm saying is it's. You kind of get used to that sort of, you know, peaks and troughs, and you know, like, you know, you support your team through thick and thin.
Yeah,
you know, I've been at the stage where St Kilda, we've won the wooden spoon more than any flipping club, and I've still been a member of the club, you know, and I've been a member now for, what, 17 odd years, I think it is. So that's...
And we survived the Lou McCarry era at Celtic, mate. We survived the Lou McCarrys.
Yep.
When that was the lowest of the lows, that was the real lowest of the lows, but we stuck by them.
And that's the thing, this is when you find out real supporters. People, you get the fair weather supporters that come out when things are going well for you.
Yeah.
And yeah, that's all right. You can get the support for that, but it's that real hardcore. You need those people that will literally support the team through thick and thin.
Yeah.
You know, and it was like, I was laughing at some of the guys and homeboys the other night talking about their old stories. And it's something that made me kind of laugh. Because we're talking about your favourite trip to England and that sort of stuff. And
yeah.
I didn't travel that. I didn't have much money. I was a student at the time. So I think I only ever really went down to England for the Tony Mowbray testimonial. I was thinking to myself, you know, like what you do to actually go to games. Now I used to work in Clydebank, lived in Airdrie. I used to get the bus, the train from Clydebank all the way back through Glasgow, all the way back to Airdrie, literally get home, get in, get changed, and then go on the supporters bus back in Glasgow again.
Yeah.
And that's the sort of stuff that you just did. And so you did it through thick and thin, and I can still remember standing in the jungle when there'd be 15,000 in the crowd, and I still remember crying my eyes out when I thought it was Paul McStay's last game. I still remember all these things.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and it was always the same 15,000-20,000 people that went, you know, every week. That was the real diehards. Didn't matter what the score was. You still went and supported the team. You had a whinge and a complaint at the end of it if you didn't win, but...
Yeah.
And that's what the team need at the moment. They don't need people. It's just going to have a go at players.
Yeah. I agree with that, mate. And again, that's what makes the likes of ourselves do things like this as well. We're living half the world away from paradise, as it says on our Twitter. But... you know, the passion doesn't leave us. We maybe don't get caught up. I certainly don't get caught up in it as much as I used to in terms of the after match. I used to hate nothing more. See, if we'd coming back from a game that we'd lost, I just wanted to try and get it out of my system. But you'd invariably always get stuck into a bloody discussion about it, and then everybody's picking holes and things and stuff like that as well. Whereas I was always, I'd still always end up getting involved in that kind of debate and discussion, but it just annoyed me even more, and I just wanted to get it out of my system. But it was too difficult, because then if you were out in the pub then that night, you were talking about a game, or somebody would say something about a game, and they brought it all back, and then going to work the next, on the Monday or whatever, and as I hinted at earlier on, you've got the few Seth Conians that would be around giving you the wind up, and it brings it all back again. At least with us over here, you can kind of, like, after that Dundee game on Wednesday morning, just as the game finishes, that's pretty much when my alarm to get me up for work is going off. So it's about 5:45 in the morning. But I was able to just shut it down. I looked at a couple of things on Twitter, a couple of things on Facebook, what was said about it. But then I was in the shower, get ready for work and get away and forget about it. And not a soul says, so how did Celtic go on last night? And you know what I mean? You can put things into perspective and life goes on. But it doesn't mean to say I feel any less strongly about Celtic when it comes down to it, or when it comes down to the games. But I'm happy that I'm in an environment that it's not in my face 100%. I can seek it out when I want to, but it's not there. It's not on the radio. It's not on the telly when you turn it on. It's not in the newspapers. It's, you know what I mean? You can seek it out when you're over here through the internet and through Celtic TV and through all the great podcasts that are out there and stuff like that as well. And I think that's the way I like it. That's the way I like it right now.
Yeah. Oh, there's pluses and minuses for it. When you do have the big win, like the Barcelona game, I wanted to tell everybody.
Oh, yeah.
You know, you're won't. I not putting.
You wouldn't want to be anywhere else. Yeah, you wouldn't want to be anywhere else in paradise and on a night like that. Yep. That was. You're right. You're spot on. In fact, I got a call. Who was it called me? I got a call. I was up in bloody Caratha or somewhere like this, and I got a call in the middle of the morning, right after we'd beat them, and he was pissed out. He said he was up in Perth as well, and. He was pissed out his head because he'd been up and he'd been bevying all night, and he was phoning in sick that day at work. Oh, that's brilliant, Kev, that's brilliant. And I was just about to go out to my work as well. I was up Caratha going on a site visit or something like this. And it was so bizarre. It was unreal. But you thought, there'd be nothing like being back at Celtic Park right now for that kind of celebration. And all the great times that you would have then when you go back. We'd go up to Columba Club and stuff like that, back in Coatbridge, and back up there and you're having a sing song and the bevy and all the rest of it. So you're right, you miss the good times as well, but when the bad times are there, it's good, you know, you can dip in and out it.
You literally switch off and that's it. You just forget
all
about
that's it. That's it.
And
exactly.
I'm kind of the same as you. There's about I'd say maybe 3 real soccer fans at work, and there's only one that really talks to me about, you know, he's a Sunderland supporter. Mm-hmm. An Aussie guy, so he'll like he came up to his other day and he was chatting about the whole thing with Gaza. singing his wee song and stuff like that. So that was having a bit of a chuckle at that one. So so he'll chat to him about it, but he knows not to say anything when things aren't going well.
Yeah,
just leave me be. So I kind of like it that way, I guess, to a certain extent. But I do miss when it comes to those big games. That's why, in a roundabout way, I know people back home will squirm when they hear these sort of things. But when it gets to the new Glasgow Derby next year, at least we'll get four big games where we can actually all catch up and stuff. So, but yes, it's good and bad, pluses and minuses, but wouldn't change it for anything. Especially, you know, I don't know what your weather's been like, but you think of over here, the weather's been absolutely glorious. I saw rain today for the first time in about 3 weeks.
Oh, right.
You know what I mean? It's just like it came through. It was like a shower for about half an hour, and that was it. It's gone. You know, now it's sitting here with a pair of shorts on and a singlet, and it's lovely and warm, whatever. But it's weird because I kind of watch your games back home, and it's freezing cold. And people are wrapped up, and you kind of feel cold. Oh, yeah, it's lovely. You're sitting there going, "Oh, it must be really good." And then, like, wait a minute, it's roasting. So, very quick one. Higgs is on the chat room. He's asking about the stuff in Perth. So, Higgs just got onto the Perth CSC stuff on Facebook. And check out the details there. So he's saying that he'd love to go to the Perth thing. So Higgs,
definitely. If you're wanting any information at all on it, Higgs, just send it. If you're on Twitter or on Facebook, or you can send us an email as well if you want to halftheworld88 email address. You'll find if you look up the Perth CSE on Facebook as well, there'll be some information coming out there. There's been a lot of planning going on in the background for it, and it does, believe me, the guys up in Perth, it takes a hell of a lot, and it ain't cheap to organise either. So the effort the guys up in Perth are putting into it, I'm a periphery figure, I have to say, but the effort they're putting into it is phenomenal. It takes quite a bit of doing. So it has taken a while to finalise things and be in a position to start broadcasting it properly. But it's going to start. You'll be hearing an awful lot more about it.
Yep. We'll coming on here to try and sort of promote things like that.
We will promote it as best we can on here as well, because it's guaranteed it'll be a great weekend. I should say, on the Friday, I think there is golf getting arranged for the Friday afternoon as people start arriving from interstate and things like that in other parts. But it'll be great. Just get in touch with us, and I'll give you any questions you've got on it, Higgs, as well. So no problems there.
Right, just quick shout-outs to everyone in the chat room. So it's Eamon down in Tassie. He's been on a fair few bits. So Eamon's one of our supporters now. He calls us a supporter. But... Eamon, yeah, Eamon's a good fella. He was actually winding me up about the guy from Lanark, because I forgot that Eamon was from down that way. So got Tom Sheheed as well in the chat room. Dominic, Chris McMahon down in Geelong. Nice one, Christopher. Tom Doherty, they're all saying that goal that Van Dijk scored was a winner. It was 2-1, I think.
It was a winner, yeah. I couldn't remember, was that an equaliser or a winner, but I just knew it was a relief goal.
FR Live from Rotterdam has a message in. Whoever FR Live is, thank you very much. Nice one.
Very good.
And, yeah, I didn't check Twitter that much tonight. It was obviously Paul.
No, I was on. It was quite quiet on there. Tom Doherty had sent in, and Paul Moody, he was obviously pleased to see we were back on as well, which was good. And Paul Larkin, that was nice of Paul to tweet in as well, telling you to calm down, Pat. So thanks guys for interacting. And it's good to be back, Pat, isn't it? It's good to be back.
It is. Because, as I said, there's no Celtic fans at work, you know, and I don't really get to talk. My kids aren't really into them just yet. The games are on a bit too early in the morning for them, so... Yes, it is. It's good to vent a little bit, because there's obviously a lot been going on.
I feel sorry for poor Liam as well, because Liam was very keen to get on tonight as well, but he was away for a job interview, I think, and it was running a little bit late, and he was struggling to get back in time. So he did say earlier on in the day that he was in the mood for a good rant, because he's had a bit of a tough time, poor Liam, over the last few weeks with things. He's obviously been wanting to have a bit of a vent about the Celtic situation as well. So hopefully the next time we do a podcast, which hopefully won't be another 3 or 4 months down the line. Hopefully we might get back into a bit more of a fortnightly routine like we used to have. But we'll play it by ear, we'll see. But hopefully it's the full complement next time as well for the next podcast.
Yep. I'll just give a quick shout out to our sports club, Jockstein CSC in Melbourne. We are now officially homeless. The pub where we met.
Ain't on punt.
Yeah, they've closed and restructuring and all that sort of stuff, so we are out in our arse. So haven't spoken to Sean Fitzgerald and the guys about what's happening. There's a couple of things in the pipeline, but nothing definite just yet from last time I spoke. We are homeless.
Carry out down the park.
Might be that way, yes.
If there's
any big games between now and end of the year, Christ, if we play the Huns and a Sevco in a final, we're in a bit of trouble. Nobody show it. We might have to join up with the Rangers Supporters Club and watch it with them. Yeah, that'd be a laugh.
Don't lower yourself to that. There is a big game coming up between now and the end of the season. It's Greenock Morton on Sunday. It's massive.
Well, yeah, well, I'll have to watch it in the house then, because there's nobody to watch it anyway. So. That's pretty crap.
Well, good.
But yes, we're on Facebook, got a website and all that sort of stuff. Just do Jockstein Celtic Sports Club Melbourne, you'll find us somewhere. So, that'll be the shout out for us. Hopefully we'll have home next time we speak to you. But so a couple of things in the pipeline. And that's it. So I'll play out just quickly another couple of AFL songs that Kev hates me doing. Because he hates me doing it,
I thought you'd forgotten this theme, Pat. You started this theme up with a few podcasts last season. I thought by now, after 3 months down the line, you'd have forgotten about this, but no, you've kept it going.
Who have we got tonight? That's a damn good question. Who have we got tonight? We have got North Melbourne, so North Melbourne Kangaroos, and Port Adelaide Power. And it's okay, it only goes for 3 minutes. That's two club songs. The North Melbourne one only goes for a minute. So. But all good.
I should get the Melbourne, then I take it as half the world away to send this right out, no?
Well, I need to do the Melbourne Victory one some night, because that is fair on dreadful. You've obviously heard the Melbourne Victory one, haven't you?
I don't know if I have, actually.
There's a Scottish theme, that's all I'll say.
Okay.
So, yeah, you can listen. Anyway, that's enough for us.
Right. All right, okay. Good night from me, good night from him, good night.
Yep, hooroo everyone.
Hail, hail.
So join in the chorus and sing it one and all. Join in the chorus, North Melbourne's on the ball. Good old North Melbourne, they're champions, you'll agree. North Melbourne is the team that